The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... G. Marshall. Welcome to the wonders of your own imagination. For although I am about to tell you a horror story, it is really your imagination that will bring it to life for you. I shouldn't even say I will tell it, for it's really the story of Edward Somerset, as recounted in his private journal dated London, 1874. A truly harrowing account of what took place at Moreland Manor.
There'll be no need for me to enter the crypt, I trust.
I don't believe so. Edward?
No. The will merely states that the coffin was to be left open for a week and food and water left nearby.
The master was always afraid of being buried alive. Deathly afraid.
As many are. It's an all too common occurrence in these times. But no, you needn't enter the crypt, Hobbs. Miss Trezillian must do that. And I must accompany her. The will demands it.
Our mystery drama, The Headstrong Corpse, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by George Lowther and stars Suzanne Grossman and Gordon Gould. It is sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, brewers of Budweiser. I'll be back shortly with Act One. As you may know, it's a custom of mine, a hobby, if you will, to read old diaries and journals, the accounts of lives written down by people long since dead and in their graves. Recently, I had the good fortune to come across the journal of a certain Edward Somerset, a young London lawyer, barrister, the English would say, who tells a grisly tale of what took place at Moreland Manor in the year 1874. According to Edward Somerset, let him tell the story in his own words, just as he recorded it in his journal.
And so, this being the appointed day, I took the coach to the village of Berly, 20 miles south of London in Kent, and in spite of the storminess of the weather, made the trip in less than 4 hours. I found Margaret Trezillian, the girl I loved devotedly, but who, alas, shall never be mine, in a terrible state of nerves.
Edward, how glad I am to see you.
And I you, my darling, though I feared you'd not welcome the sight of me.
Oh, darling, if only I'd never consented to marry Richard Westmore, never given my promise.
You had no choice.
Is there no escape, no way out?
Only if Dr. Westmore releases you from your promise, rescinds the marriage contract you and your father signed.
He'll never release me. In fact, he's coming for the weekend. He'll be here this evening to set the date for our marriage.
Perhaps if I were to have a talk with him...
Now,
what's all that?
Hobbs and Mrs. Murchison having another of their quarrels.
That, Mr. Hobbs, is that.
Oh, no, it isn't, Mrs. Murchison, by no means.
We'll see, Mr. Hobbs, we'll see. Miss...
What is it now, Mrs. Murchison? Since we buried my father a week ago, you and Hobbs have quarreled without let-up. What is it this time?
It's him and his lofty airs, that's what it is. Sir Simon was hardly cold in his coffin before Hobbs began lording it over me and the other servants. Now your father is dead, he seems to feel he's in charge.
I am. That's the way Sir Simon would have wanted it. Oh, begging your pardon, miss, but as you know, I was butler and personal servant to your father before you were born. I've been with this family many years, most of my life, in fact.
Whatever this disagreement between you and Mrs. Murchison may be, we'll discuss it another time. At the moment... we must go to the crypt. Fetch a lantern so you can light the way. Well, why do you stand there?
Oh, there'll be no need for me to enter the crypt, I trust.
I don't believe so. Edward?
No. The will merely states that the coffin was to be left open for a week and food and water left nearby.
The master was always afraid of being buried alive. Deathly afraid.
As many are. It's an all too common occurrence. But no, you needn't enter the crypt, Hobbs. Miss Trezillian must do that. And I, as a representative of the law firm of Costain and Loring, must accompany her.
Yes, sir, but when it comes to putting the lid on the coffin and screwing it down...
I'll do that, since it seems to trouble you.
Oh, thank you, sir, and I'll fetch the lantern.
You may go, Mrs. Murchison. We'll discuss this matter later.
Very well, miss. But Hobbs is becoming... He has become impossible. Oh, now, who could that be on such a day as this?
Whoever it may be, let him in out of the storm, Mrs. Murchison.
Yes, miss, at once.
Oh, thank you, Murchison, thank you. Frightful day. Soaked to the skin.
Lord Burley, what brings you out on such a day?
Well, all days are good days for business, my dear.
Business? Oh, I apologize. I haven't introduced you. This is Mr. Edward Somerset of Costain and Loring, my father's solicitors. Edward, Lord Burley.
How do you do, sir?
You're here on business, you say?
To be exact, to make another offer for Moreland Manor, my dear.
You've chosen a bad time, my lord. Though, really, any time would be bad. As my father told you more than once, I think, Moreland is not for sale.
Wrong tense, my dear. It wasn't for sale, but it is now. Or I happen to know soon will be.
What gives you that idea, Lord Burley?
Excuse me, miss.
Hobbs has brought the lantern, Edward. Lord Burley will have to excuse us.
I had forgot. This is the day, and no doubt the time, for paying a visit to the family crypt, eh? Your father had a fear of being buried alive. Well, I'm sure you'll find him dead enough.
May I ask how you happen to be so well acquainted with the private affairs of Moreland Manor? How do you know this is the day we were to visit the crypt?
There's little goes on in Berly, in the county and the village, sir, that I don't know. Good day to you, sir. And you'll be hearing from me again, Miss Trezillian.
Terrible man.
Oh, certainly is. Well, Margaret, it's time.
Yes.
Hobbs, lead the way. Here we are. I'll open the door. Give me the lantern, Hobbs, and wait here.
Oh, yes, sir.
Come, Margaret.
Edward, I can't enter that awful place again.
I'm afraid you must. It was your father's wish.
So cold. Damp, so...
Oh. There. There's the open coffin. Let me just shine the lantern inside it to be sure your father's body is still there. Yes, it is. Look, Margaret.
Yes. The body is there.
Go outside now. I'll put the lid on the coffin and screw it down.
All right. I'll wait for you with Hobbs until you... Edward.
What is it?
There's something strange here. Something... curious. The clothes on the body.
The clothes?
That isn't the suit we buried my father in. In fact, Edward... Oh, good Lord. It isn't my father's body.
Now,
Margaret. Edward, I tell you, it isn't. You knew my father. He was much... taller. And he was thin.
By heaven, you're right. But this makes no sense at all. It's his head.
Yes. It is. I'm going to faint.
Outside, quickly. I'll join you.
Miss, what is it, miss?
Something horrible. Horrible.
Oh, what, Miss Ward?
I don't dare say it, Hobbs. I don't dare think it.
Mr. Somerset, sir, what is it? What is it in there?
The thing in the coffin. It's Sir Simon's head, but not his body.
Not his body.
Someone cut his head off, stole his body, and put another in its place.
Incredible. Utterly incredible, Somerset.
Dr. Westmore, what I've just told you, I saw with my own eyes. So did Margaret. In fact, she was the one who first noticed it was the wrong body.
Where is she?
Resting. Or perhaps I should say recuperating. It was an awful shock for her.
No doubt. Have you notified the police?
No.
Well, why not, man?
There's only a constable in the village, and I've heard he's anything but competent. I intend to send a message to the London police by coach tomorrow morning.
Well, better still, I'll take it for you.
I'd rather not wait till you leave on Monday.
Oh, I'll not be staying the weekend now. Margaret will be in no mood or condition to discuss our wedding plans. And as a surgeon at London Hospital, I have much to do. No point wasting my time here.
You don't exactly sound like a man in love, Dr. Westmore.
In love?
With Margaret, of course.
But I'm not. Nor is she with me. It's all purely a financial arrangement, you understand.
Well, no. I didn't quite.
Oh, but of course. An arrangement I made with Sir Simon. He was a very ill man for nearly a decade. He sought my rather special services, if I may say so. But as you know, Moreland is mortgaged to the hilt, and he was unable to pay.
In return, he offered you his daughter's hand in marriage?
And Moreland Manor. Even though the estate is heavily mortgaged, it'll give me a tidy sum. A fortune, in fact, once I sell it. Now, look here, let's go down to the crypt. I want to see for myself.
I'll ring for Hobbs first. You say you're not in love with Margaret?
Not in the least.
I am.
Oh, are you indeed?
And she's in love with me.
Yes. Yes.
I don't know quite how to ask this, except to ask it. Will you release Margaret?
Why, of course not.
Even if... Oh, Hobbs.
You rang, sir?
Yes. Dr. Westmore and I want to go down into the crypt. Bring a lantern, will you?
Yes, sir.
Oh, and tell Mrs. Murchison she can serve tea in half an hour.
Yes, sir.
As I was saying, Doctor, even if Margaret signed over all right to Moreland to you...
Why should I bargain for what will be mine once we marry?
And if she refuses to marry you?
Well, she won't. Margaret is a woman of honor.
What do you know of honor, Dr. Westmore?
Now, if you mean to insult me, Somerset...
I mean to give you the truth. I've had you investigated, Doctor. Quietly, but thoroughly. I happen to know that you have twice been brought before the Royal College of Surgeons on charges of conduct unbecoming a physician. Charges which could not be proved for lack of evidence.
I was not guilty.
That you are presently under investigation by the same College of Surgeons... who this time do have the evidence to revoke your license. And will, Dr. Westmore. Because you are considered unworthy of the name doctor and will be barred from medical practice.
You have been thorough, Somerset. Perhaps, under the circumstances, you'd prefer I went down the crypt without your company.
I'd better go with you, since one of the charges against you is that of body snatching. Take the lantern, Hobbs. You wait here.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Oh, and you told Mrs. Murchison about tea.
Well, I'm sorry, sir, but I couldn't find her about.
What do you mean? She must be somewhere in the house.
No, sir. At least I was unable to find her, and you did want the lantern right away, sir.
No matter. This way, Westmore.
Those coffins stacked one on top of another. And their occupants have certainly been dead for years.
Some of them for nearly a century.
Curious. That's Sir Simon's coffin there, the one with the lid off?
Yes. And as you can see, the body isn't that of Sir Simon, but...
Good Lord! What in the name of... Here, raise the lantern. Let's have some more light. You did say the head was Sir Simon's?
It was.
But this is... It's the head of a woman.
Katie.
Katie?
Katie Johnson. The maid.
What's this? Well, it's incredible. First, if I'm to believe you, Sir Simon's body was exchanged for another. And now his head? Is this some sort of a joke?
I don't think so, Westmore. But if it is, it's the joke of someone gone mad. Stark mad.
A baffling mystery, wouldn't you say? You might even call it heady. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. Edward Somerset's Daily Journal, recording what took place later on, is even more baffling, and I'm afraid more ghastly. Most of this strange story, the body of it... There I go again. All I meant to say was, there's more to come. And so, I'll be back shortly with Act Two. Shocking things. But I must confess that even I, somewhat of a connoisseur of the shocking, was totally stunned by Edward Somerset's account of what happened following the gruesome discovery that Sir Simon's head had now been replaced by Katie Johnson's. If I was appalled merely in reading about what had taken place, the feelings of those who actually lived through these ghastly events can be imagined.
But where is my father's body, head and body? Whose body is it in the coffin? Who killed Katie Johnson, severed her head from her body, and put it in my father's coffin? What?
Margaret, I beg you, enough. I can't answer even one of your questions, let alone a dozen.
I didn't ask a dozen, Edward.
You needn't snap my head off.
No. We're all somewhat nerved up.
Talk. We sit here talking when we should be doing something.
Perhaps you have a suggestion, my dear Margaret?
At least one murder has been committed in this house. Possibly two. Katie Johnson and whoever's body that is in my father's coffin. Shouldn't we notify the police?
The village constable is worse than useless. Dr. Westmore has offered to take a message to the London police when he leaves in the morning.
You'll not be staying the weekend.
I may soon cease to be a doctor, Margaret. Certainly if the College of Surgeons rescinds my license. But I still retain some remnants of the gentleman. You are certainly in no mood to discuss our wedding plans.
Neither now nor at any other time.
Ah, well, you have no choice there.
Perhaps she does. Or could have, if, as you say, you do retain some gentlemanly qualities.
You refer to the suggestion you made earlier, just before we went down into the crypt.
Yes.
What suggestion?
That Westmore release you from your pledge to marry him in return for Moreland Manor, which, after all, is really what he wants.
Not quite, my dear fellow. Not altogether quite.
What do you mean? If you don't love Margaret...
Love has nothing to do with it. It's a matter of convenience and what is best for me.
I don't understand.
Well, you would if you'd allow me to finish. Once my license to practice medicine is revoked, and it will be this time, I'm sure, I shall go into business. Contacts, important contacts, are vital to business success. And the making of contacts requires a good deal of entertaining. So you see, I shall need a wife to fill the role of hostess. Does that answer you?
Yes, I guess it does.
I beg your pardon, Miss Margaret.
Oh, Hobbs, yes.
You asked me to find out where Mrs. Murchison had got to, and I have, miss.
Where did you find her?
In the kitchen, sir, where she claimed she'd been all the time. Only she hasn't.
Did you tell her I want to see her?
Yes, miss, he did. And I came straight along.
Where have you been the past hour?
In the kitchen, miss. Preparing tonight's dinner.
Mrs. Murchison, more than an hour ago, I asked Hobbs to let you know he wanted tea, and he couldn't find you.
Well, I don't know why not, Mr. Somerset. I've been in the kitchen all that time. And as for tea, there was no need to give me an order. Tea is always served in this house at 5.
Then why didn't you serve it?
Too busy getting dinner, miss. I gave Katie instructions to serve it today. She never got to do it. God rest her soul.
Hobbs said he couldn't find you. Not anywhere.
Well, that is a lie. I have been in that kitchen the last 2 hours. Never left it once. He's lying, he is. Trying to get me into trouble.
Oh, come now, Murchison. Why would Hobbs want to get you into trouble?
Because I know too much about him. That's why.
and he's afraid I might tell what I know. He wants to see me dismissed.
The woman is mad. Stark mad.
Am I? We have been paid no salary in this house for 6 months. Now, not that I'm complaining, as I'm not. But ask him how he can afford to buy the finest of vintage wines to swill down his gullet. Ask him who pays for the costly cigars he smokes. And ask him where he gets the money for the expensive suits, shoes, whatever he wears when he goes to London on his days off. Ask him.
Is it true, Holmes?
Why, yes, miss. I'll not deny that I enjoy good wine and a fine cigar. How do I pay for them? Why, miss, your father paid me well in the many years I served him. I was able to save considerable. And that, miss, is all there is to it. Though Mrs. Murchison would like you to think otherwise.
Think what?
Well, Mrs. Murchison? Nothing, miss. I've said too much already. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a roast cooking.
1 minute.
Sir?
The inside of your right arm. I just noticed when you turned. It's smeared with what looks like blood.
Blood?
Well, look at it.
Oh. Oh, yes. Is it blood, Mrs. Murchison? I guess it is. Yes, preparing the roast, cutting it, I must have got a smear of blood on me.
Is that how you got it, Mrs. Murchison?
What do you mean, Dr. Westmore?
Nothing. Nothing, Mrs. Murchison.
May I go, miss?
Yes. And you too, Hobbs.
Oh, yes, miss.
Well, she could have got that blood on her from cutting a roast of beef.
Or from cutting something else. My suspicions of Mrs. Murchison were sharply aroused. I had myself stated to Westmore that whoever was responsible for these ghoulish happenings must be mad, stark mad. I was speculating on all this in the drawing room after dinner, paying little attention to something Margaret and Westmore were discussing, when, to the surprise of us all, Lord Burley was announced for the second time that day.
His lordship, miss.
Good evening, Mr. Zillion. Mr. Somerset. Oh, and you, Dr. Westmore.
Good evening.
Lord Burley.
Sir?
I thought our business had ended this afternoon.
Ah, no, my dear. Business, sound business, that is, never takes no for an answer. Since I could not reason with you, I decided to ride over and, if possible, reason with your husband-to-be. To answer your look, Doctor, yes, I heard you were here.
Is there anything you don't know, Lord Burley?
Very little, very little. As your betrothed may have mentioned to you, I'm interested in buying Moreland Manor.
She didn't mention it, no.
Ah, yes. Well, I am prepared to make you, all things considered, a quite decent offer, Doctor, once you come into possession through marriage, of course. Would you be interested?
I would, indeed. Why do you want Moreland, my lord?
Well, it adjoins my own estate. The 780 acres of Moreland would be a welcome addition.
I should think so, yes. What are you prepared to offer?
£1 per acre, £780.
That isn't an offer, Lord Burley. It's an insult.
Not at all, not at all. If you look at it in the right light, Doctor, all things considered, as I said, it's really something of a compliment.
As attorney for the estate, I can assure you it's worth a very great deal more than £780.
Oh, can you, Mr. Somerset? Can you indeed? In your position, you must also be aware that the estate is impoverished.
Yes, but...
That taxes are now a year in arrears.
Yes, still...
I know. You entertained the hope, the forlorn hope, Mr. Somerset, that through proper management, through improved land production, you might salvage the estate.
I would hope that Dr. Westmore would, when he becomes owner.
Well, hasn't he told you he means to sell more land within a month, perhaps less? You'll be willing to settle for shillings.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, quite simply, my dear, that there will be no one here to run the place for you. No servants, no farmers, no stable help, no one.
Why not?
Because of the strange things taking place here. I refer to the occurrences in the family vault, are already known in the village, and the people are frightened. Within a few days, they will shun Moreland Manor as if it contained bubonic plague.
But this is... Impossible! Well informed as you may be on what goes on in Berly, you couldn't be this informed. Unless...
Yes?
Nothing.
No, I insist. Unless what, my dear?
I said nothing.
But your silence signifies everything. If you're implying that I have a more than ordinary knowledge of what is going on here, that I am in some way involved, then out with it.
That is indeed what I do surmise.
Well, then let me assure you that you are wrong. I have my sources of information, yes. I have my informants, indeed a network of them. But I am not, I repeat, not a body snatcher.
Body snatcher?
Oh, good Lord, man, what do you think is behind all this?
Body snatching.
Oh, heaven help us, what naivete. Do you think someone is simply playing games, having some sort of ghoulish fun? You, Miss Tressilian, and you, Mr. Somerset, yes, I can understand it with you two. But Westmore, you? Do you mean to say you haven't suggested this possibility, that this probability, to these two young people?
Should I have?
Ah, but you know better than anyone the need of bodies for dissection purposes, for the training of medical students. Medical schools will pay £10 for a fresh body, and 15, as you damn well know, sir, for a fresh head.
Really? You're far more knowledgeable than I am, sir.
Oh, you know nothing of it, eh? You, whose case is on trial this very moment before the College of Surgeons for just such practices, you know nothing?
What is he on trial for? I thought it was body snatching alone.
Oh, that, of course. But in the eyes of the authorities, something far more vile. Dr. Westmore is a grave robber.
What?
Yes, my dear. He not only snatches corpses, but robs them as well.
Is this true?
I own to nothing.
You needn't. Your face says all.
Blast you, Lord Berly. For what you've done to me these past minutes.
I to you? Have you not done it to yourself, sir?
Yes. Heaven above help me, yes. But I had hopes, stupidly had hopes, that I might repair the damage I've done others and myself. I dared to hope that with the monies I would receive from the sale of Moreland, I might regain some reputation, some respect, some personal dignity.
I ask your pardon. I had not known you. You had in you even a spark of decency.
Only a spark. Nevertheless, a spark, which I might have fanned into flame.
And you may still. What I have said has been said within the confines of this house.
No, Lord Berly, it has been said within the confines of this woman's heart. And will echo there till the day she dies.
Ah, well, I am sorry. But now, as to my offer to buy Moreland Manor...
Another time. We'll discuss it another time, if at all.
Now, then I had best take my leave.
That would be best. And Lord Berly.
My dear.
Don't come back.
The revelation of another side to Dr. Westmore's character, a good side, came as a surprise to both myself and Margaret. Unhappily, this better side of Dr. Westmore, as Margaret and I discovered in a long discussion with him following Burley's departure, by no means influenced him in releasing Margaret from her obligation to marry him. When finally he had retired for the night, Margaret and I sat hopelessly talking of the future.
Edward, I love you so. And the thought of marrying Dr. Westmore, I shudder at it.
I too, my darling. There must be something. Something.
What? What solution have you thought of?
One that only God could arrange, I'm afraid. Westmore's death.
Oh, Edward.
Frankly, there have been times when I've been nearly driven to arrange it myself.
You mustn't say such things, Edward. Not even think. 2 in the morning. No wonder we're having such wild thoughts. We're tired. I'll say goodnight to you, my dearest. Edward!
What in heaven's name?
Mrs. Murchison!
But where is she? Where are those screams? Oh, the crypt.
The crypt?
It's not that way. Stay here.
No, I'm coming with you.
Here's the crypt. Don't come in, Margaret.
Nonsense, Edward. Oh, Mrs. Somerset. Oh, Mrs. Somerset.
What is it, Mrs. Murchison? What are you doing here in the crypt? What's happened to make you lose control?
There. It's Simon's coffin. Go and look. See for yourself.
Good Lord.
Edward, what?
No, don't look, Margaret.
I must. Oh, my God.
When I came to that part of Edward Somerset's journal, I could hardly wait to turn the page to find out what new horror had taken place in the crypt. And a horror it was. A shocking horror. As you'll discover when you turn the page, so to speak, shortly, after I return with Act Three. Shall we turn that page of Edward Somerset's journal? Personally, I could scarcely wait to do so. But I am used to horrors, can sort of take them in my stride. While you, on the other, you insist? Very well, then. We turn the page.
Margaret, for all her delicate beauty, is a strong woman, a woman of courage. But as she looked into her father's coffin, and the words... escaped her lips. I feared she was about to faint, but she somehow managed to retain control. When I was sure she wasn't about to collapse, I turned my attention to Mrs. Murchison and said, "Pull yourself together, Mrs. Murchison."
I'll try.
And answer me. What are you doing here in the crypt? What? And at this hour of the morning? Answer me.
I wanted to clear myself.
Clear yourself?
To prove my innocence. Now, last night, when you saw the blood smear on my arm, the way you looked at me, all of you, the way you talked, I could see you suspected me of doing these foul things. What brought you here? What could you expect to prove here? I don't know. I only know I couldn't sleep. I tossed and turned, all sorts of thoughts going through my head, all sorts of needs to prove to you that your suspicions of me were unfounded. I came down here in desperation, I suppose, thinking I might find something, some clue, some bit of evidence that would give the lie to Hobbs. Instead, I found that.
What do you mean, give the lie to Hobbs?
I was in the kitchen all the time he claims he was looking for me. The time when poor Katie was murdered. Oh, and so that blood on my arm was from cutting the roast beef from nothing else.
So you say.
You don't believe me still.
Why should I? We find you here in the crypt under very curious circumstances, and you expect us to believe your not very convincing story?
It's the truth. I swear to you, sir, and you miss, it's true.
That's to be seen. The question now is, what's to be done?
Edward, the police must be notified as soon as possible.
Yes. Dr. Westmore was going to take a message to London tomorrow morning. Well, someone else will have to do it now.
Edward?
Yes?
Are we dealing with a madman?
I'd say what's in that coffin answers your question, Margaret. If we had found Dr. Westmore's head, just the head, I might still have some doubts, but not anymore. Not after finding Westmore's head with the lips cut off.
Terrible. Terrible what happened to Dr. Westmore.
Yes.
Will you be long in London, sir?
Only overnight. I'll return in the morning with, I hope, some member of the police force who can get to the bottom of what's going on at Moreland.
Strange, strange. First Sir Simon's body taken, but his head left in the coffin. Then his head gone and Katie's... Oh, poor girl. Her head put in its place. And now Dr. Westmore's head in place of Katie's and the lips cut off. Oh, horrible. Horrible.
Very.
Have you any idea, sir, as to what's behind this?
I have my suspicions, Hobbs. But that's all they are, suspicions.
Well, now, you'll be sure to return on the morning coach, and so I'll be there to meet you.
Yes.
Depend on me. And there now, you see, the village just below us in the valley. I told you we'd be in plenty of time.
You've hardly touched your dinner, miss.
I'm not hungry, Mrs. Murchison.
Oh, small wonder. All that's happened here. And some of the village farmhands telling you today that they'd not be coming back to Moreland to work the fields. I'll see who it is, miss. Lord Burley.
Is your mistress at home, Mrs. Murchison?
I'll see, my lord.
No need. I'm sure she is.
I thought I had informed you, Lord Burley, that your presence here is no longer desired.
You may change your mind about that.
If you've come to see me about...
I've come to see the crypt, if I may have your permission.
Whatever for?
I learned today that a good number of your farmhands have left you because of the doings here. Well, for my benefit, once I own Moorland, I think it best to clear up the mystery of the crypt as quickly as may be.
You think you can?
I know I can. Because, you see, I know, on good authority, the reason behind what's been going on.
Is it body snatching?
Yes. So, in any case, I am informed. But I wish to see for myself before taking action. I have your permission.
Very well.
Now, come along, then. Now, first I want to look in the coffin. Ah, poor Westmore. Lips mutilated as I was informed.
Whatever it is you wish to see or do, will you do it quickly?
To be absolutely sure, I'll open the top coffin on this stack.
No, you can't do that. It's sacrilege. That's the coffin of my mother.
I'm afraid it was the coffin of your mother, my dear. In truth, I'm afraid many of these coffins no longer contain their original occupants. They are now used as storage boxes for much fresher corpses. Ah, with your permission, then. Yeah, so, see for yourself, Margaret.
Please, I'd rather not.
Oh, come, you must. This once. I want you to know I speak the truth. Look.
Why? If bodies are in such demand, why store them away? Why not sell them at once?
Oh, my dear, you are as devoid of business sense as your father. In business, there is an inexorable law known as the law of supply and demand. When supply exceeds demand, prices fall, and vice versa. There's more demand for corpses at some times than at others, more demand for heads at certain times. At the moment, medical schools are in need of heads. Why, I haven't the vaguest idea. My informant didn't know.
I do!
What?
Hobbs! Hobbs, what are you doing here?
No need to answer that, Hobbs. That butcher knife in your hand is answer enough.
Answer enough for you? Damn your rotten soul!
No! Oh, no, you're stabbing
him to death! Help! Yeah. May he rot in hell! Eyes and ears everywhere. Nothing hidden from him. Oh, knew everything. Knew all about what was going on down here. I even knew, I'll be bound, that I am the body snatcher.
You
didn't know. You didn't even suspect. Mr. Somerset did. Lord Burley did. Dr. Westmore? Oh, yes, he more than suspected. He knew, because he was the one who bought what I had to sell.
Westmore! off.
He started me, but I ended him. I had to.
Why? Why did you have to?
He was soon to go on trial before the College of Surgeons. They have enough evidence to convict him, to break him down. And he will have told everything, including where he got the bodies, the heads, from me. Me. That's why I had to cut off his lips, so he'd never tell. Never.
You're mad.
Yes, that may be.
The bodies, the heads. How did you transport them? The nearest medical schools are in London.
I have a carriage. Well, more a wagon in the village. And the night before, I would go to London. On my days off, I would take what I had to sell into the village and stack them away in the wagon. You thought I went to London by coach? Yeah. I never did. I always went in my wagon, taking my produce to market to Dr. Westmore.
And I never suspected. I never knew.
Well, you do now.
No. No, don't. Don't kill me, Hobbs. Please, don't kill me.
I must. And cut off your lips so you can never...
No, please.
I'll be quick. It won't hurt.
No,
oh, yes. I've become very... Mr. Somerset.
You
came back.
I never went. But Hobbs will never know that now.
Oh, Edward. Oh, darling, darling. He was the body snatcher, Penny.
I know, dearest. I heard everything he said. But I knew the whole story before I came back from the village.
You didn't go to London.
I never intended to. The more I thought about it, the more it seemed that if Lord Burley could buy information, and he couldn't have got it any other way, then maybe if I spread the word in the village that I was willing to pay and pay handsomely, well, in any case, I did. And it worked.
You learned about Hobbs.
Everything.
Thank God you arrived in time.
I thank him not only for that, but for the future that lies ahead for us. There are two important tasks I shall devote the rest of my life to. One is restoring Moreland Manor to what it once was.
And the other?
Making you the happiest woman on earth.
So ended, happily, the strange and horrifying events at Moreland Manor. Edward Somerset continued his journal for many years, and I'm glad to be able to tell you that he did restore Moreland Manor to its former splendor. And he must have made Margaret at least one of the happiest women on earth, if 9 children mean anything. I'll be back shortly. The story took place in 1874. There are many who say the world was a better place to live in then. Maybe it was. I don't know. All of us do face many problems, many frustrations, many fears these days. But one fear we don't have now that just about everyone had then is the fear of being buried alive. At least, I don't think we have. Our cast included Suzanne Grossman, Gordon Gould, Anne Petoniak, Ian Martin, Kurt Benson, and George Lothar. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Now, a preview of our next tale.
Wait a moment while I light a candle. All right, Harry. There. I can't see a thing. Too dark. Too many shadows.
It's a dark diary, Harry. And it has many shadows. Here. Take this candle. Now. Go forward.
Good Lord.
I thought you'd be shocked, Harry.
Shocked? I'm shattered. Where did you get this? This hideous painting?
Basil Hallward.
Impossible. Basil never painted anything as unholy, ungodly as this.
Well, really, he didn't. I did.
You?
And you.
Dorian, I'm tiring quickly of your veiled answers. What is this thing?
It is a portrait done by Basil Hallward. It is the portrait of Dorian Gray.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser, and Buick Motor Division. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.